Hello and welcome from me, Michael Stott in the UK, and from my joint convener, Sanford Jayungar in Washington, DC, to this, the 30th jointly promoted event between the Future of the Humanities Project and the Free Speech Project. The latter is sponsored by Georgetown University and the former by Georgetown's Humanities Initiative in association with Campion Hall, Oxford, and the Las Casas Institute for Social Justice, Blackfriars Hall, Oxford. Together, the two projects consider issues concerning human dignity, rights, cultures, histories, traditions, and freedoms in a wide spectrum of educational activity, policy, expression, and aspiration. In a moment, I'll hand over to Sandy, who is the director of the Free Speech Project. He will introduce today's distinguished guests and moderate the ensuing discussion before I return to chair the question and answer session. From the start, you can type in questions to the panel by using the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. Please use the Q&A button and not the chat button. These questions will come to me during the session, and I will try and put them to the panel to consider later on. We urge you to ask questions as and when they occur to you so that there's not a backlog at the end. So I hope you enjoy today's debate. Over to you, Sandy.
Thank you very much, Mike. Wonderful to be working together again on this extended series of international dialogues. We have a panel today we're very pleased to present. This is the third in our programs dealing with issues of democracy. We did one on Brazil 2 months ago, on Israel last month, Iran today, a slightly different theme because we're not sure what democracy means in Iran. We'll talk about that. And there'll be others coming up in the future. On May 3rd, we'll talk about World Press Freedom Day. But I'm very happy to introduce today Senem Naragi-Anderlini, who is founder and CEO of the International Civil Society Action Network, or ICANN, I'm an adjunct professor at Columbia University School of International and Public Affairs. Marjan Kipur is a human rights activist and advocate for women and minorities in Iran. She's the founding director of the Alliance for Rights of All Minorities and joins us today from New York. Fatali Mogadam is our colleague at Georgetown University, professor of psychology, returning to our international dialogues, I believe, for the second time on subjects of mutual interest, and we're glad to have you back, Ali. Michael Nazir-Ali is president of the Oxford Center for Training, Research, Advocacy, and Dialogue, or OXTRAD, I believe you would say, and was the 106th Bishop of Rochester in the UK for 15 years until 2009. He has both a Christian and Muslim family background and has sat in the House of Lords, British and Pakistani citizenship, and extremely qualified to look at some of these issues from multiple perspectives. I want to begin by asking each of you to how you would personally characterize the crisis going on in Iran today. I don't think there's any doubt there's a crisis in Iran, and that a lot of people are worried because of Iran's nuclear program and other reasons, but I wonder what all it is we need to be worrying about. What characterizes today's crisis? Senem, do you want to begin?
Thank you. That's a big question to start off with, and I'm sure I won't have a complete answer. But the way I would say, I think there are different perspectives on this. So on the one hand, one of the things which makes the what I would call the women life freedom movement different to past events is that this is a culmination of at least three generations of women since the start of the Iranian Revolution and the Islamic Republic. That culmination of these of three generations of women coming out and demanding rights, basically basic rights. It's the clarion call is a very feminist message. Women, life, freedom. What makes it extraordinary is that this is the first time, not only in Iran, but around the world, where we're seeing a movement that has a revolutionary feel to it, but where women aren't just leading the effort, but the message is a feminist message. We've had women lead in Sudan. We've had women lead in Yemen, and even in Egypt in 2012, women were at the forefront of a lot of these push of these movements for democracy. But the message wasn't, the uniting message wasn't one that was situated around women's rights. This time in Iran, this is what it is. It's a culmination of three generations, as I said, of women fighting for their rights across the board. And again, what makes it unique is that it has unified people or inspired people across gender. We have men standing together with women. That's never happened before. Class, geography, sect, ethnicity, et cetera. It's all around, it's been all around the country, and it's among young children. So when you have your 12-year-olds and your 13-year-olds basically demonstrating opposition, if you want, in one way or another to the ruling regime, it's very hard to change that mindset. And the regime's attitude, of course, has been to crack down heavily and to sow fear and do all these things. But I don't think that you're going to, I don't think this shift in mindset and this openness and this, as I say, this message of women, life, freedom, and all that it brings with it is going away. I think it's there to continue to spread and hopefully nonviolently, which is the way most women-led movements are. Thank you.
Father Michael, how would you characterize the crisis in Iran?
Well, I think it has very deep roots. There is a culture of repression that since the revolution itself, and indeed before then, civil society is weak. I do understand what is being said about these demonstrations, but civil society organizations are weak and have been weakened. What worries me most of all about this crisis, and indeed past crises that have also occurred, is that there is a kind of political, military, market tie-up in Iran, which conspires against greater freedom for people, whether these are minorities, or freedom for women, or indeed freedom for citizens in Iran generally. And how to shift that, I think, is the challenge, because the revolutionary movement, having confiscated many of the assets of the Shah and of Western powers, have invested these in the bazaar. So there is an interest in the market itself to perpetuate what is going on. And of course, the religio-political establishment is heavily involved. So of course, it's wonderful to see these brave people out in the streets, risking their lives, sometimes losing their lives. But the political agenda will only shift if the market decides it's no longer economic for it to be allied to these people. And if the armed forces decide that they can no longer brutally suppress their own people.
Thank you. Marjan.
Thank you for this opportunity. I would add to what the panelists have said already and characterize the crisis or the moment in Iran as one of both evolution and revolution. A moment where the frustrations of the past 40 years and the efforts to repair and restore the elements of freedom and dignity in Iran have transformed into a moment of revolution. Where people are trying to take matters in their own hands and fight with everything that they have got to obtain liberty and freedom and dignity. The three words of woman, life, freedom really capture the essence of what they are looking for. And unlike the past 40 years, they are realizing that there is no more legitimacy and possibility of working with the current regime. And therefore, they're trying to take matters in their own hands through the Revolutionary Act by participating in a numerous array of acts of civil disobedience, of which street protest is only one. And we can talk about what are some of the other ways of this revolutionary expressions. But they are telling the world that this regime is no longer a legitimate regime for them, and they want to overthrow it. And then regionally, they are fighting with an atmosphere where foreign governments are at a loss and in a state of confusion as to whether they should recognize the Islamic Republic as a legitimate entity or whether they should honor the will of the Iranian people and encourage them to nominate and elect their own leaders to be as representatives of the future Iran.
That's a very stark difference between the two, and obviously very much in play. Professor Mogadam, you're on mute at the moment. There you go. Can you tell us how you would define the crisis?
I'm a psychologist, and I would place this current Iranian situation in two contexts. One is the process of change, psychological change, from more dictatorial to less dictatorial. I don't believe we have any fully developed democracies, but some societies have made more progress towards democracy. So that's one context. The second context is the transition when there are anti-dictatorship revolutions. And I've been studying these, and in most cases, anti-dictatorship revolutions simply transform one dictatorship to another form of dictatorship. There are very few successful revolutions in history. I don't include the American Revolution, which I regard as a rebellion against an external force. So from my perspective, the way to understand Iran better and the women life freedom movement better is to really place these in historical context in terms of the psychological changes taking place and the changes that are necessary in order to move towards a more open democratic society. And unfortunately, in the Iranian case, what we had was transition from one form of dictatorship to another, which is the classic case. The French, the Russian, the Chinese, the Cuban, all these revolutions simply transform one kind of dictatorship to another. And so we have to keep in mind the historical context of changes and the very great challenge of psychological changes necessary in order to move towards democracy. And the phrase I would introduce here is political plasticity. How difficult it is to move in political behavior in different areas. I'll give you an example, leadership. Why is leadership so difficult to change? For example, in the United States, we still are not near having a female in the White House. So it's not just Iran, it's a global situation. Thank you.
Thank you. Speaking of that, we were maybe a bit exaggerated in our title for this forum when we asked, can Iran recover its democracy? I think perhaps I should ask, is there a democratic moment in the past? Is there a time that the Iranian people can feel nostalgic about, even if the current citizens have not lived through that moment? I mean, I know people who like to characterize the Shah's time as one of great enlightenment. And I suppose if you were in the right social class and had the right friends, maybe you could practice a life of enlightenment at that time, but it was not by any definition democracy. So is there a moment, Sanam, is there a moment in history that you would look back to?
A couple of things on that. I think it's been a democracy in attempt, let's put it that way. We have the 1906 constitutional revolution that was trying to sort of limit the power of the of the dynasty, you know, the king at the time, and bring parliamentary constitutional rule. We had, of course, 1953 with Mossadegh and the attempts at, you know, nationalization of oil, and again, kind of limit the power of the monarchy. And then bringing it to the Shah's time, I was 11 when the revolution actually took place, and I was definitely growing up in a social class that was supposedly of that extreme privilege that you're talking about. What I found extraordinary was that we were largely brought up with the principle that, in Persian expression, that the walls have mice and the mice have ears. Divar mushdara mush gushdara, which means there was very little political talk. I can tell you, for in our school books, for example, we celebrated the nationalization of oil. That was marked. That was a national holiday. But I hadn't heard the name Mossadegh until I arrived in England in 1979. And I'm related to the man. There, you know, the idea that during the Shah's time there was some, you know, notion of open speech and so forth is a bit of a fallacy. I do remember just at the time of the revolution, sort of in the fall of 78, when the press was given more freedom and political prisoners were released, that there were reports in the newspaper. And I remember my mother reading to us the accounts of people having been tortured in prison and so forth. So there was a sort of window, I think, in the September of 78, maybe through to the end of 79, that there was some opening again, but then it got immediately shut down. And so many people were executed in those early years and months of the coming of the Islamists. So many political opposition groups and people who returned to Iran thinking that they were gonna have a space then ended up back in prison, including again one of my aunts who was a member of the Socialist Tudeh Party. She came back from Eastern Germany and ended up being the oldest female political prisoner in the world under the current regime. So there are these moments of opening and awakening, and then Ali says, dictatorship begets dictatorship, and we shouldn't assume that the current change doesn't also lead us, you know, we could end up becoming like Egypt, where you have a military dictatorship with the guise of a suit. It's very hard to move towards democracy avoiding violence. And that's my work. It's like, how do you do it? How do you do a South Africa? How do you do a Tunisia? There are lots of other exits that are much more dangerous, and we have to consider them.
Anyone have any other thoughts about democracy? Marjan?
Yeah, what I wanted to add is that, yes, we do have moments in history where certain elements of freedom and democracy or hopes were ignited. And even if things did not materialize at the moment into what the people had aspired for, there is at least memory of those. But there's also a Persian proverb that says, "Adab az ke amukhti az biadaban." Who did you learn your manners from? From the rude people. And yes, maybe Iranian people have not succeeded at achieving what they wanted through examples of success in the past. Nonetheless, they're very observant. We have to realize that over 90% of the population in Iran is literate. Over 70% of the population in Iran has connectivity. And they are paying attention to what is happening around the world. And they have been harmed enough and hurt enough and yet aspired enough to look at what is happening around the world throughout the history and also continue with their aspirations. So they are looking at those failures of revolutions and failures of movements of the past. And I really believe that they are they're going to make history by showing a new way. Just this movement that we are talking about, as Sanam said, it is exemplary in and of itself. And I think that Iranian people will make history by learning from the collective successes, but also the collective failures of history.
Thank you. Yes, Ali.
I'd like to make just three points. One is that I went back with the revolution, and initially in 79, we did have freedom. I was teaching in universities in the spring of revolution, And we were very free for about 5 or 6 months before, you know, the hostage taking and all that took over. The second point is that when you study revolutions, it's much easier to overthrow a regime than to set up a democracy after.
Of course.
That's very easy. Third point is I agree with Marjan that we have to be optimistic in recognizing that this woman life freedom movement is very progressive and constructive, and they're learning from others. But theoretical learning is different from the psychological skills needed to implement a democracy, and that's in mind. Yes.
Of course. Father Michael, what about the taking a step back, the role of women in Iran overall? Some of our panelists have spoken quite eloquently of their leadership in the current moment. But this all began with focus on the morality police and the hijab regulations and so on. But are there larger points we made about the role of women, and is some change in that necessary before Iran can really move forward at all?
Yes, thank you. Before I come to that, I mean, there are examples of successful revolution. Some have been mentioned already by Sanam, but for example, the disappearance of the Iron Curtain. I mean, so many countries were freed to some extent and democracy introduced in our own lifetime, certainly in my lifetime. So it can be done. And also, we shouldn't look for sort of absolute outcomes. You know, there can be relative outcomes where there is some freedom, but not everything that we need, at least in the intermediate period. May I tell you a story?
Please.
I was in Tehran at the same time that the Cylinder of Cyrus, you know, the great decree by the Emperor Cyrus of freedom for his subjects throughout the Persian Empire had been loaned by the British Museum to the National Museum in Tehran. And I was in a dialogue with some people from the Foundation for Culture and Islamic Relations there. And I thought I would open what I had to say by noting that the Cylinder of Cyrus was in Tehran as I spoke. And the person opposite, who was chairing the meeting, who was the vice chairman of that organization, the Sazimani Farhang, I'm sure you've heard of it, he said to me, he said, "We are not interested in the past, we are only interested in the future." And I thought that was a very strange kind of comment to make. Because there has been this aspiration for freedom among the people of Iran. Even the Greek historians note that whilst there were empires and the kind of almost godlike status of the Shah and Shah, the concept of Far-e-Izadi, nevertheless, that in local communities, there was a kind of democracy that operated. Some of the aspirations and the movements that arose have been mentioned already. One, of course, was the resistance to the tobacco concessions, which was actually led to a great extent by the religious leaders who were for popular participation at that time. So that it's not impossible. Certainly the 1906 settlement was a hopeful one, which gave some role to the religious leaders, but in the context of a democratic order. It could have worked if the First World War and the disorder that it caused had not overtaken, and the coup d'etat of Reza Shah had not happened. So there have been episodes, and yes, I think the freedom that Professor Muqaddam experienced did last for some time. However, by the time the Iran-Iraq war broke out, it had completely ended. I was in Iran at that time, and it was the most tragic place to be in, because a whole generation was sacrificed during that war in a way that was almost casual. Women, I mean, it's a paradox, I think, the situation of women in Iran, because it's not like Afghanistan, for example. I mean, you know, women are still in the professions, a very large number, perhaps a majority of women in the universities. They can hold and do hold political office. Many of the spokespeople for the regime are women. I mean, you know, so we have to understand that. And I mean, the point about literacy and so on has been made. Tertiary education, at least in some spheres, is open to women, but not all. That is a question that has to be addressed. There has been, I mean, until now, I don't know what will happen now, but in the cities like Tehran or Isfahan or Shiraz, there was a kind of a turning of the blind eye to how women were expressing themselves in public. I'm not sure if there is a crackdown, what that will result in. Foreign women that I've been with in Iran have felt the oppression more than I have, and I think they're better judges of that. So I have taken how they have felt very seriously as a signal of how Iranian women must feel.
How do we explain the brutality of the crackdown against these protests? Perhaps it's just a resistance to change. Perhaps it's just an established elite not wanting to give up power. But it seems, at least while it was very much in the news until recently, it seemed like an extreme level of brutality and death sentences and children being arrested and so on. Ali.
After the Second World War, psychologists did a lot of research on the kinds of people who supported Hitler. And if you look at that research, it's very relevant to the kinds of people who support Khamenei at the moment. These are highly authoritarian, dogmatic men, mostly men, low in education. They are very, very threatened by women, competent women, highly educated women. So we can tell psychologically who is going to support this regime and the kinds of policies that these people want. And one of the policies they want is high aggression against dissimilar others, particularly women.
Sana.
Just to add to that, I think we see a variety of things. Number one, the regime has always been pretty brutal, but we also have a culture in Iran of historically thinking about sort of the domestic sphere and the public sphere, and we call it Andaruni and Biruni. And in many ways, you could argue that a lot of the violence was maintained in that Andaruni and that domestic. It was hidden, and we didn't necessarily see it. And I'm interested in what Ali says about the psychology, because I think we're also a culture that doesn't like to display victimhood. And therefore, we don't actually talk about the violence and the trauma and what's been done to us and so forth. There's a lot of pride in kind of not bringing that out. In many ways, the last 40 years, we haven't really heard a lot of what has happened to people. That's one thing. This time around, we saw it in the street. And as Ali says, it's there's a visceral, it's almost like watching the incel movement, you know, the involuntary celibate kind of movement, in terms of how viciously they were attacking women when you see them, you know, literally beating people up and so forth. I think it's also related to the existential fear, because when you think that if this is really a revolution that's going to bring down the system, and you as a man are part of that system, and not only you're part of the system, the stick in your hand is tied to the bread on your table and you're feeding six, seven other people, the existential fear of what's going to happen to me, I think drives all of that. And then one last point, we mustn't forget the women that are part of the system as well. And this revolution, you know, back in 1977, 78, when they started mobilizing, they mobilized and recruited women like many extremist movements do. They understood the power and influence of women. So they've coerced and co-opted it for themselves. And women often join these types of movements or systems to have adjacency to power. And so they are integral to these things as well. And so, and then finally, I mean, it's the more threatened they feel, the more heavily they will crack down and sow fear as a way of trying to sort of push people back. We see a pattern. Every time there's a public protest over the last 30 years, it's been heavy crackdown, a little bit of backdown, heavy crackdown, a little. So this is, I think, the same pattern. It'll be interesting to see what, when things calm down, really what happens in terms of women's expression in public and the girls who are going out in the street completely without hijab now, what happens. Right now they're putting it around their scarf around their necks and show, you know, they have it. So if they need to put it up, they'll put it up. But it'll be interesting to see really what the regime's game is going to be and what scare tactics they're going to use against women moving forward. But we see the crackdown and backdown kind of as part of their strategy of releasing the pressure but maintaining control.
I want to move on in just a moment to Iran's geopolitical role, but stay for a moment with the cultural questions. Michael, did you have something you wanted to add now? And then I want to talk about for a moment a book that was very well-known and celebrated some years ago called Reading Lolita in Tehran, which described a sort of furtive cultural flowering in some respect, that as long as nobody noticed, people could exercise intellectual curiosity. And Marjan, do you have anything to say about that?
You know, I think that Iran is not Afghanistan, but Iran is ruining the Taliban. And we are seeing elements of the current regime's behavior that in some ways are mocking and emulating the Taliban's attitude toward women. Look at what they're doing in the schools with poisoning of the schoolgirls. They are, you know, yes, we have had a generation of educated and intellectual strong women that probably is a result of, you know, what was created before. And, you know, the Minister of Education in Iran was a woman during the Shah, and her work was based on providing an equal level of education between men and women, of regarding women as equals. It was fundamentally about men and women being equal, which and that fundamental element of democracy was eliminated as soon as the Islamic Republic came into power. It was one of Khomeini's first promises and beliefs that men and women are not equal. Men and women should not have the same level of education. And so whatever we have had in terms of the strong educated women, majority of college graduates of today, doesn't mean that it's going to continue in the same fashion should the Islamic Republic remain in power in the next 40 years. Because of how they're assaulting girls who are seeking an education as young as elementary school age, and because of other rules and and cultural changes that they're inculcating into the society, like child marriage, like forced marriage, like encouragement of temporary marriages and the questioning of rape, blaming rape on women, blaming all kinds of other societal ills on women's desire to have freedom. So Yes, women have been exemplary and successful in Iran, but we have to recognize that the Iranian regime is trying to change that through step-by-step cultural changes and assaults on women and girls, including the poisoning of the girls and including the societal norms, such as child marriage and forced marriage.
Sounds horrifying. Really,
I think there is, Sandy, there is a fundamental tension in Iran between culture and ideology.
Mm-hmm.
So the culture runs much more deeply than the ideology, obviously, for most people, if not for everyone. I mean, just to tell you another story, I was in a delegation for a dialogue with Shia clerics in the holy city of Qom. And after that, they gave me a gift and I didn't open the gift. I thought I would go to my hotel room and then open it. When I opened it, it was a fully illustrated, published in Iran, fully illustrated copy of the Rubaiyat of Omar Khayyam. And I thought to myself, why are these clerics giving a Christian bishop such an explicitly illustrated copy of these sensual poems? And the answer is that they thought it was an example of culture. At least that is what I thought was the reason. I hope I'm right. And you know, you go into a bookshop, certainly in the big cities, and the Iranian poets are on sale, Sufi poets are on sale. There's quite a lot of, you know, I found translations of the works of St. Augustine and of Thomas Aquinas on sale in Iran. So there is this fundamental tension between culture and ideology. And I hope that this revolution, this crisis that is going on, will show us that it is the culture, the deeply embedded culture of the Iranian people that will triumph.
We're going to move in a short time to Mike Scott and the questions that have come in. I see there are quite a few, but I want to raise first this issue of the geopolitical role of Iran at the moment. I think most people see the mullah's support of Russia in Ukraine, very active, unabashed support of the Russian attack on Ukraine, as particularly cynical. In Syria, I don't know whether the role has been constructive in any respect or not, perhaps in some, but they seem to be gambling their prestige and their influence on some fairly dodgy causes, don't you think, Sena? Well,
I would take it back just one step in terms of the geopolitics, because I think that what we see is the Iranians, you know, since 9/11, have basically the regime. Basically, it's been a essentially protect and survive. You know, they're about themselves. So back in 2003, you know, they helped the US actually get rid of the Taliban originally. That we have documented evidence from American officials. They offered, you know, in 2003, they said, we'll help you with Saddam, and they got the axis of evil in response. And so, you know, since then, basically, what they did was they said, you know, if America's going to come into our neighborhood, we will go back into the neighborhood. We're going to protect our own boundaries and so forth. And I think that's been the general rule, you know, that they'll create chaos in Iraq. They'll do what they have to do in the region. With Syria, I think it was more about the fact that the Syrian regime had helped Iran during the Iran-Iraq war. So it was more kind of a payback. But what I find interesting right now is that as this women life freedom movement was happening, the Saudis played a brilliant game, because what they did was, since 2016, when the JCPOA was signed and they didn't like it particularly, they've been using media, Iran International and Manotu Television and others, to blast a lot of criticism and a lot of nostalgia about the Shah's time and so forth, and you know, sort of create a different psychology at the public level. With the rise of the women life freedom movement, again, Iran International has been pivotal, but it's owned by the Saudis. And meanwhile, Saudis have been negotiating with the Iranians. And the reason why I think this is happening is that Iran, Saudi Arabia, Saudi Arabia, UAE, and Israel, actually, it would not be to their benefit if Iran emerged as a viable, legitimate democracy, especially a women-led or feminist kind of signifier of a democracy. Because the minute you have that, you would be challenging what the Saudis are doing with Wahhabism, what the Israelis are doing with the Palestinians, the autocracies around the region. So I don't think that I think that the strategy was always to weaken the regime and then make a deal with them, which is exactly what they've done now. So we're seeing an alignment of autocracies essentially in that region, and it's kind of coming in line with the rise of autocracies, you know, the Russians and others, and the demise of Western, you know, the US and the West in that region and elsewhere. But and coming back to the point about the Taliban is that the way we negotiated, the failure of the negotiations with the Taliban and the way the US and NATO withdrew from Afghanistan and handed the country back to the Taliban, we're just beginning to see the effects of that in the region and around the world. And it is a nasty, nasty, very insidious sort of state that is emerging. And but the countries in the region are playing their own game to figure it out. But Iran will, I think the regime will do whatever it takes to survive. That's, they don't, you know, for themselves to survive. I don't think they necessarily care that much about the public or the well-being of the public. They'll do enough for them to be calmed down, but or to be suppressed. But I think that that whatever they're doing in the region, it's you have to look at it in terms of their own survival.
Anyone have thoughts about their role in Ukraine?
Well, not the Ukraine, Sandy, but I mean, just to continue from where Sanam has ended, the West's presence in the region is not virtuous. I mean, that should be clear. We shouldn't assume in any way that it is. If you think of the support that they've given the Saudi Arabian regime over so many years as a close ally, thereby allowing it to repress its own populations. But in Syria, for instance, that was mentioned, the West is supporting the very movements that it was opposing in Afghanistan, in Syria. And an incidental result, actually, of Iranian and Russian involvement in Syria has been to allow the kind of significant minority presence in Syria, whether it's Christian or Alawite or Druze, to survive, because if the Assad regime had fallen to the Sunni extremists, we would have another kind of Afghanistan in Syria with no future for the minorities whatsoever. I think the reason why Iran is in Syria has to do with its attitude to Israel in the end. But an incidental result has been that the minorities in Syria have survived for the time being against a vicious kind of Sunni extremism, such as we see in Afghanistan. But the West's withdrawal from Afghanistan in the way that it happened has signaled that it cannot be trusted, that it will leave people to their own. I remember talking to the Pakistani foreign minister about the so-called double face that Pakistan was presenting vis-a-vis the Taliban. And he said to me, the Americans are going to cut and run. We have to live with these guys. What do you think we should do? So I think all of that has to be taken into account.
Sure. I see there are quite a few questions that have come in. So let's go to Michael Scott and continue this conversation, but in the context of the questions from participants on the outside. Michael.
Well, thanks very much for the discussion. It's I have to say, just listening to it, it's been a little disappointing, disheartening, because it's been a good discussion, but a disheartening, because where do we find solutions to this? And it just struck me, and I want to go to Ali Mogadam first, really, with a question from me first, which is, this is all to do with tyranny, it seems. And we've got tyranny in the world. We've got tyranny elsewhere. We've got those problems with Russia. What's the psychology here, Ali, in terms of a tyranny? And where in your experience of your reading in psychology, where can you find some kind of positivity about getting rid of the tyrant?
Well, we have to be realistic, and countries all began as dictatorships, and some have made some progress towards democracy. In order to develop democratic citizens, we have to have mass education that will enrich democratic citizenship. At the moment, we have elite education that does that in some countries, but not mass education. So the bright side is that we have the know-how and the technology to bring about mass education for democracy. And the challenge is to get the political leadership and the political elite to see this as a priority and to engage in changing democratic citizenship. That is the long-term optimistic goal. So I am optimistic, but I tend to be a long-term thinker rather than short-term. And I agree with a lot that has been said, particularly about the distinction between ideology and culture. And that is an important point to keep in mind, but also that in order to have a democracy, we need democratic citizens, citizens with the psychological skills and tools to participate in a democracy en masse. So we need education for that. So I'm optimistic in that sense.
Well, thanks for that. Can I go to a question from Kyle Marsden? He said, it takes this on, really. Where do the panelists see pro-democracy leadership emerging from? And what role can the Iranian diaspora play? Who is capable of taming the IRGC? Sanam, do you want to try that?
Where is democratic leadership coming from? I think that if you look at the young people, and especially the women in Iran, you will see profound democratic leadership. And feminist movements generally around the world right now are one of our most important hopes and most targeted sectors because of this idea of these issues. But they are there. We have amazing women leaders. They are in jail, but they remain inspiring, and people know them. And so that, I think, is where it's at. In terms of the diaspora's role, I think that there are two things. One is that the diaspora, we have different diaspora. We have people who've been here 40 years. We have people who've just arrived. And what Ali's saying about the democratic mindset is actually really important in the context of the diaspora, because what I worry about is that if you have grown up within a system that is a particular mindset of the regime, you bring that mindset out. You know, if the regime tells you that anybody who works with a media or the government is affiliated with a government or is a spy, you bring that mindset out. And then you come into a world where you have freedom of expression, and you have that mindset and freedom of expression, and you basically are saying whatever you want. That's not democracy. That democracy is actually respecting each other's human rights as well, and respecting freedom of speech. And living in a democratic society means dealing with nuance, dealing with compromise, dealing with people you don't like, and not assuming that just because you don't like them, they need to be canceled and shut down and killed. And unfortunately, we have a lot of this stuff coming out into the diaspora. And I think that there's a lot of work that needs to be done with the diaspora communities that we have. The other thing which I think is fascinating is that I also work with a lot of people who come out of dictatorship or live in dictatorial settings. You know, when you live in a dictatorship, you have no rights, but you also don't have any responsibilities. you don't have civic response. If there's trash in the street, it's the government's fault. If there's, you know, environmental problems, it's the government's fault. So I think one of the things that is actually really interesting about Iran that the Khatami period tried to do was to foster civic engagement and activity. So we may not have very big, loud civil society organizations, and they certainly shut down the ones that become powerful. But this idea of ordinary people picking up themes and deciding for themselves to be engaged, whether it's in, as I say, trash collection, environment, you know, whatever, these are all part of that idea of democratic mindset of having self-empowerment, enablement, and pushing and wanting to have change and saying we have a role. So these are also part of the positive things that I think we're seeing there. But again, as going back to what Marjan was saying, the early warning signs of how they're going after girls' schools and how they're shutting down. It's still early, you know. But we have to watch how they do this. And I'll end with one thing: sanctions are really, really bad, because when you impoverish people, they do end up going off and marrying their daughters at a young age, especially the very poor. And when you don't have other income, you do go and work for the state and so forth. So we have to be careful about whether from the outside world, the sanctions and the economic pressure we're putting on is on the regime or on the people. And at the moment, to me, the regime has actually become strengthened with years of sanctions that we've had.
Michael, I saw you nodding and looking serious on that, but do you want to come back on that?
Yes, no. I mean, I agree with quite a lot of what's been said, but there is a tradition within the ulama, within the religious leaders in Iran, of thinking about democracy and promoting democracy. I'm thinking of people who are very senior. I mean, Ayatollah Montazeri, for instance, was at one time deputy supreme leader, and he had a clear vision of how a Shia Islam could relate to a democratic order. And for that reason, because he voiced these ideas, he was demoted and imprisoned and so on. But there are followers of his around still. Ayatollah Tehrani, who has campaigned for greater religious freedom, is another figure, even for the Baha'i people. The Hausa Ilmiya in Qom has a very fine library and has been a place where ideas about democracy and a Bill of Rights, for instance, that's not been mentioned in our discussion, but very important in a populist situation, that we don't just leave it to popular will, but to safeguard through a Bill of Rights fundamental freedoms. I mean, all of that is discussed. Mufid University in Qom is another place where these discussions are taking place. So I think where we can engage with these currents of thought, we should do so. But also to empower ordinary people. I mean, connectivity was mentioned, I think, by Marjan, and that's right. But access to information and getting information out is crucial, I think, in this context, so that the world comes to know what actually is going on, and people in Iran understand how the world is standing with them. I think all these aspects can lead to real change. But in the end, I think it will be the realization by the armed forces in Iran and by the Iranian market that they cannot continue to support a regime that represses its own people.
Marjan, do you want to comment on that?
I just wanted to say a couple of things, if you don't mind. Number one, to associate child marriage with sanctions is really a misrepresentation of reality. When there are every few years, they are actually, the Iranian regime is literally changing its own laws about and lowering the age officially for marriage. It has nothing to do with sanctions. They are making a deliberate choice to sexualize children, boys and girls, and to encourage that. They are not making any changes to religious writings about sexual abuse of children. None whatsoever, independent of sanctions and economic depravities of the country. Not also, we cannot talk about sanctions affecting the Iranian majority of the Iranian population without talking about the Iranian government itself mismanaging its economy and the kleptocracy that has been prevalent in the country for the past 40 some years. The sending of the finances and resources of the country abroad. I mean, you cannot blame sanctions independently without blaming Iran's own mismanagement of its finances. And then related to that, probably, because you also mentioned Israel as a country that would not want Iran to be a free democracy, Israel is the only democracy in the region. However imperfect, it is the only democracy in the region, which even has members of the minority participating in its government. We saw in, you know, if you criticize what is happening with Bibi Netanyahu, but we saw last year, you know, members of the Muslim population, the Palestinians, having a role in the government itself. And especially because Iran is the number one existential threat to Israel, I don't think there is any country that would love to see a democracy in Iran flourish more than the state of Israel. I also have thoughts on diaspora, role of the diaspora and leadership, if I may.
Yes, please.
Going to the question of who is going to lead a future Iran, I think we have seen, as the co-panelists have referenced, yes, there is such an environment of repression that any emerging charismatic leader, even anyone with a pen, including the two women who broke the story of Mahsa Amini, are still in jail. So any form of new thought and ideology and leadership and aspiration for future, when it's expressed, is at risk. The moment it is expressed, it is at risk of suppression. And because of that, the opposition movement inside Iran has evolved to focus its attention not on the individuals, but on the ideologies, exactly, you know, what was referenced, the theme in this conversation. They are supporting ideologies, not individuals. And the ideology that they go back to time and again, in every version of a charter that has been created since the beginning of the Mahsa revolution, represents a solid and unchanging support and belief in democracy, in a secular democracy. And that's what people want. And that should be the role of any diaspora and any allies, Iranian or non-Iranians, who want to support the people of Iran, to support a free and democratic secular Iran.
Thank you for that. Susan Wolf has, talks about the regime is so dangerous, so suppressive to the women of Iran in particular, and the women are so courageous, but they're also incredibly vulnerable to the regime, to the violence, the poisonings, the shootings of children and so on. And she asks, how can the West support them more? Now, a little earlier on in the discussion, of course, we did point to the fact that the West's reputation is not so good in all of this, is it? You know, so how do we find in the West some kind of means to have an influence when it all the time people, tyrants, can point and say, but look what you did. How do we do that? Michael, you're nodding.
Yeah, I think providing greater connectivity in all sorts of ways so people's voices are heard outside Iran, and they know that the world is also engaged and listening. I think that does have an effect on things like brutality, on repression, on sort of egregious kinds of elements of what the regime is doing. The other way is to give more attention to the United Nations and its instruments. So we have not at all mentioned the work of the UN rapporteur on Iran. His report at the five-yearly review of the United Nations Human Rights Committee was devastating. I mean, I've got it in front of me just now of what is happening. And the response of the regime is feeble in the extreme. I've got that in front of me as well. I think that kind of forum has to be used more, reporting on the situation by providing greater access to information from Iran and to Iran would also help. Regional pressure can assist. I mean, I know that what is happening at the moment in the kind of rapprochement between the Gulf powers and Iran has a dark side to it, undoubtedly. But ending Iran's isolation can be a good thing if people get to hear more of what is going on inside the country.
Yes, please, Sanaa.
Yeah, just on a couple of points. So what we did research in Iraq in terms of the impact of sanctions and what the gender dimensions of impact of sanctions are, and the correlation with poverty and people in areas of extreme poverty and how they end up giving up their girls for early marriage is there. We have that evidence. We did a study in 2012 when the sanctions, the heavy financial sanctions were being imposed on Iran with women in Iran, and they were raising these issues. So I don't think it's either or. I think the regime, as Marijan says, has a strategy and has its own ideology, and it's a very insidious ideology. And at the same time, these blanket sanctions end up having a huge impact on the economics of the wider populace and force people into very dangerous activities. And often women are the most affected. So I think that's one thing to bear in mind. The second thing is on the question of democracy within Shiism, which is true. I think there's a lot of very interesting discourse and debate in that space. That said, one of the challenges that we've had, and when we've had Iranian Islamist scholars come to Washington and Georgetown speaking and so forth, I've raised this with them, is that, you know, saying that you have pluralism and we're willing to deal with people from different sects or religions and different communities is one thing. Ask them about giving women equal rights. And there's suddenly literally I've been told things like, well, if the women don't like it, they can leave. We have a problem in Iran with the constitution being Sharia law and that Sharia law being interpreted in a way that I am not an equal citizen like Ali is. When I go to court, I represent half the witness value that he has. So until and unless Shiism is willing to deal with us as, you know, women as equal human beings, there is a huge challenge in terms of, especially with the way that Sharia law is being interpreted in Iran right now. And you can't have democracy if half your population are fundamentally not equal. We have Jewish representatives in parliament. We've always had them from before. We have, apart from the Baha'is, I think other minority groups actually do have political representation in the Iranian parliament. But when you think about it in terms of basic fundamental rights, we are not equal within the current legal framework in Iran. So that needs to be dealt with by Shiism, or hopefully by secular democracy, as Marjan was saying, which is basically where we would all like to end up.
Yeah, I mean, I think there has always been in Shia, among the Shia ulama, a more traditional approach to the Sharia and another approach which could result in an interpretation of Sharia that leads to a recognition of equality, not just for women, but I mean, we can't reduce this whole thing to be about women or about minorities or any particular group. I mean, we have to talk across the board. And the situation of the Baha'i community, men and women and children, is terrible. I mean, it really is. And indeed of the many converts to Christianity from Shia Islam that now exist in Iran who have no legal status whatsoever. I may be wrong, I hope I'm wrong about this, but I think the initial step in Iran will be of a democracy that takes Shia Islam into account. I can't see a straight jump to a secular polity just like that, unless something very radical happens. But this has happened in the past. The 1906 constitution was mentioned that envisaged a role for the ulama, although an advisory one, in the constitutional arrangements. That also was the case under the Shah. And Montazeri, in his vision for democracy, also saw an advisory role rather than a role with formal power for the ulama. I suspect that is what will happen in the first instance anyway, in any kind of transition, if it's an orderly transition. But there has been a lot of creative thinking about Sharia, both in Sunni Islam, particularly in Sunni Islam, but also among Lebanese Shia, people like Mahmoud Ayyub, which can be used to persuade people that inequality is not a necessary corollary of respect for Sharia.
Thank you. Marjan, I think you were signaling you wanted to speak.
Yes, I just wanted to indicate something. And while there is definitely a strong religious roots in Iran, both on the Shia and Sunni levels in Iran, there's also a very significant movement of turning away from religion that is taking place in Iran. And including very respected Ayatollahs who were so disenchanted by the abuse of religion by the regime that they have actually decided that they will take off the garb in a ceremonious way, and they would do away with the presentation of office of the clergy, because they have been so turned away. Some of the more progressive Ayatollahs have been mentioned, like Ayatollah like Khatami. Like, we have to recognize that or Montazeri, as soon as they have made progressive remarks, they have been banned from appearing in the media, and the regime continues to suppress the aspects of religion that doesn't convenience them, while promoting aspect of religion that actually helps them stay in power. And sticking to aspects of Sharia law that suppresses women is one of the aspects of religion that they push and continue to insist upon, because when they suppress 50% of the population, they keep alive a system of oppression that ultimately empowers them and keeps them in power. So yes, there are strong religious roots in Iran, but there's also a very strong movement away from religion, including from the highest level of Iranian clergy.
Thank you. I think we're going to have to draw to a close now, but it just struck me one thing that you said, Michael. Perhaps the United Nations should be more involved. And I think of the 17 Sustainable Development Goals, which are, of course, number one or two or three is to do with gender and equality for women. Whether the United Nations should actually be getting more vocal about this specific problem. I'm going to ask you that.
One clear demand that could be made across the board is for Iran to allow UN rapporteurs, not just on Iran itself, but on other aspects such as gender, such as violence against women. These rapporteurs exist, and they have been denied access to the country. Now, there should be a demand, a unanimous demand from all nations in the UN for such access to be allowed, unfettered access to be allowed to these rapporteurs.
Fine, thanks. I was going to ask you one comment on that. Michael. Sanam, yes.
Very, very quickly. So I've been involved in the Women, Peace and Security agenda of the Security Council since its inception. And this is a moment for the Security Council to actually bring Iran under that agenda to the Security Council in terms of women's security, women's protection, and so forth. Similarly, April is actually the month that the Security Council often looks at sexual violence in conflict and the use of sexual violence by state actors and others. Again, we have incidences of this type of abuse. It's time to use those instruments to bring Iran into that space and have it be taken seriously. So I agree. I think that we have to use our multilateral tools and systems and really be consistent. And there's now a movement to try and make gender apartheid illegal in international law. And again, depending on the criteria, I think Iran also fits in there. So we have to use the rule of law that we have and universal human rights as mechanisms to try and bring about the change or some of the mitigation, because I also worry about using women's rights or any of these things, again, as a way of promoting war, which we've also seen in the region in the past. And that's not a good outcome for women.
No, what we're talking about is the development goals, which are wide, which, because the gender one is specific within them. However, Ali, do you want to make one comment about United Nations?
Yes, I completely agree. The UN should be much more involved in this situation. But at the same time, I would also urge people to look at continuity across regimes as well. There's certain problems in Iran that are not just with one regime or the other. There are continuous problems. By the way, the Shah is largely responsible for bringing about the Islamic Republic. It was the Shah's policies that strengthened mosques. He built thousands and thousands of mosques and made the connections between mosques and networks and religious groups very strong, because he believed they would defeat the communists. He thought the left wing was the danger. I believe he was misled by the CIA, actually.
Okay, that's those ones. Marjan, your final comment, please, before I hand back to Sandy.
I think one of the important evolutionary steps that need to happen in order for this movement to succeed is acceptance of responsibility and acceptance of mistakes. Whether it's committed by rulers or by the people, I think that you can look into who are the perpetrators or who are the contributors to the failures of the past in Iran. And I think that while maybe rulers of the past have contributed to those problems, the people have contributed and by taking the vote, by taking to the streets. We have to have a moment of reckoning and a reconciliation with ourselves as citizens in order to be able to reconcile and reckon with our enemies. You cannot put all the blame for the mistakes of the past on the authorities. People contributed to the problems as well. And we all have to take collective responsibility and in order to push forward our collective dream for a secular and free democracy in Iran.
Well, again, that's related to the whole concept of what the United Nations should be about. And let's hope that may be some kind of answer. Sandy, back to you after what has been a really excellent discussion today.
Yes, very quickly, we've swept by our self-imposed time limit here, Mike.
Yeah, sorry about that.
That's all right. It's no one's fault. But I do want to try to respect the time of our participants and our panelists. This has been a wonderful discussion. I think we've had some nuances of the points of view that were very helpful and forward-looking. And so I'm grateful to all our panelists for making that happen. And to all our participants for tuning in. Thanks, of course, as always, to our support network at Georgetown University, John McCabe, Tom Benchoff, the president, Jack DeJoya, who have encouraged this series and encouraged the both projects to continue along in the difficult times of the pandemic. So onward to the next one. Mike.
Okay. Thank you. And thank you, Sandy. May I give my thanks also to our panelists. Thank you very much for such an engaging hour and 20 minutes rather than 15 minutes. But thank you very much for that. The next Free Speech Project is a Crossroads International Dialogues event in association with the Future of the Humanities Project will be on Wednesday, May the 3rd. Now, that's earlier in May than we would usually plan, but that happens to be World Press Day. So we're going to do something on freedom of the press on World Press Day. I'd also like to mention that Tuesday, 25th of April, in the Literature, Arts and Environment series, Sheila Kapoor from Georgetown will be discussing a People's Atlas of Nuclear Colorado, which sounds intriguing to say the least. My thanks, of course, to colleagues at Georgetown, also to colleagues at Blackfriars, John O'Connor, the Regent, Richard Finn, the Director of Las Casas Institute at Campion Hall, Nick Austin, the Campion Hall Master. Also, my thanks to John McCabe, to Laura Lees, my publicist in the UK, and as ever, to Maggie Scott, who all helped to put these programs together. And my thanks to you, the audience. We didn't get through all of the questions, but I realized that some of the questions had been answered during the course of the debate, or at least discussed. So thank you all for putting in those questions and for attending today. I'm Professor Mike Scott, Fellow and Senior Dean at Blackfriars Hall, Oxford. You can follow me on Twitter at Mike Scott Prof. Until next time, take care, keep safe. And again, my thanks to all our colleagues on the panel. Thank you very much. Goodbye.
Thanks, everyone.